So how often do you do this?
I try to do as much as possible. Everybody, we are live. Thank you so much, Dynasty Mir, Search for Huru. And all the way from London, we have the visual artist extraordinaire, Asiko. Let's give it up for Asiko, the artist. And Asiko, you're Nigerian, correct?
Yeah, I am.
Yeah, Nigerian. So we're just going to chop it up about art. You know, I love art. I love the visual arts. In fact, let me show you what I'm looking at right now. Hold on one second. Let me turn this off.
You check this out. I picked this up when I was in Benin. I got this when I was in Benin. This is like a rare book. It's John Michelle Michael Basquiat.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So I got this when I was in Benin.
Nice.
In Ouida. Yeah, it's got I guess after he passed away, there was a curator that he gave his art to.
Okay.
And so the curator partnered with a foundation that's based in Benin called the Zinsou Foundation. I'm going to try to get her on, actually. Okay. And they got some real cool stuff. And I bought this. I bought another book from him when I was there the year before. So it was real cool. So I guess, you know, and it was crazy. He was actually going to move permanently to the Ivory Coast.
Wow.
Interesting story. Yeah. John, Mike, is it Michelle or Michael? I think it's Michael.
Yeah, I think it's Michael.
Basquiat. He was actually going to move to the Ivory Coast, but then he died. He overdosed.
Oh, damn.
Yeah, he overdosed. So, yeah, but this is, you know, I've been reading this, going through that, you know, some of his art. So I love the visual arts too. So, but yeah, introduce yourself. Tell everybody what you do. Everybody in the chat room, thank you so much for joining us.
Sure.
Those are here now.
Yeah. So I think what I do, it's funny. I create work that's about my journey. My journey in going back. I was born in London, moved back to Nigeria. I think when I was about one, you know, you go where your parents go, and I lived in Nigeria till I was about 16, 17. And then I moved back to the UK. So my parents wanted me to do university and all of that. But then I never moved back. Uh-huh. But I think through my years, I didn't really appreciate my culture. I didn't really appreciate where I was from.
Why, not to cut you off, but why is that? Why is that? Because I noticed that's common amongst.
I think sometimes, it's the things we're exposed to. So I watched a lot of TV, watched a lot of American TV, watched a lot of British TV. So in that way, you don't see yourself. You see people that don't exactly look like you. So in a way, you're not really appreciating where you're from, who you are as a person. So my work has been about me finding my identity, which I'm on that path and I'm enjoying. And I think, you know, it's interesting. Do we really find ourselves? But I think I'm on that path to finding who I am as an African and more so as a Nigerian. And I think that kind of reflects in what I'm shooting. I'm also interested in womanhood. I'm interested in women. That bit's hard to really quantify or understand where it's come from, but I'm just going with it. So my work's about, it's autobiographical.
All right, cool. So go ahead, finish, I'm sorry.
So it's about my journey.
Cool. Everybody in chat room, peace. What made you originally get into arts? Because you mentioned not, I guess, having images of yourself on TV, which has been a huge issue. So what made you, did that motivate you as far as pursuing visual arts or photography?
No, that wasn't even, I mean, I had, so I had a completely different career. You know, I went to school, I have a chemistry degree. I have a master's in bioinformatics, which is more about gene sequencing and scientific work. I worked in that industry for 10 years. But I always had a passion for art. And so I started creating work through that period of time, I guess through a period of time where I just picked up a camera and then I started photographing. I think me becoming more conscious and more aware of things started to happen actually through the work. So as I created more, I became more aware of what was around me and what I was seeing. And that kind of spurred on, I guess, me understanding that, oh, what I used to watch on TV or the things I was exposed to as a kid affected, I guess, what I create now, because I'm trying to go back to being, to understanding culture and identity.
Now I'm sitting here, I'm going through your portfolio on Instagram. Guys, make sure you click on the Instagram link. That's Brother Asiko's Instagram link. Make sure you like him, follow, all that good stuff. You have some beautiful photography on here. In fact, let me do this. Let me do the split screen real quick so everybody could take a look at it. Let's see here. Entire screen share. Okay, here we go. Here we go. All right, you guys see that? Yeah, it's absolutely stunning. So, you know, like I said, it's important because, I mean, see, and this is the issue. I tell people, especially us Black people, that it's up to us to, I guess, like what you're doing as far as showing our own images and that other people are not going to take the initiative, you know, to show us, you know, to tell our story. So
yeah,
instead, did you take this picture of Halle Berry?
Oh yeah.
Oh wow, this is beautiful. This is an absolutely beautiful photo.
It was it last year during one of these? It's called the Cannes Lions Festival. So imagine the Cannes Film Festival, but this is more for creative industries and people in advertising. So she was giving a talk and stuff. So I managed to get a quick snap. Mm-hmm. It was really crazy and manic, but yeah, she's gorgeous woman, and she had a lot to say, very intelligent. She had a lot to say about social media and how you present yourself and, you know, how she kind of keeps herself sane.
Let me just, where do you find your I guess, your, is the correct term, muses or models? Like, what's the correct term?
I mean, I shoot a wide variety of women. I shoot women who are models, who I kind of connect with on Instagram. A lot of stuff comes to me through Instagram, so I'm quite grateful for Instagram. I've met loads of people from all different parts of the world, and you know, when we either shoot where they are sometimes, or when they're in London, they will shoot with me. I also shoot women. So it's not, they don't have to be models or anything like that. I'm interested in women and their space and womanhood. Also, I'm interested in the intersection between culture and womanhood. So that reflects in my work as well.
All right, how would you define describe your style of photographer?
That's an interesting one. I think the works, that's very, 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 very interesting. I think it's emotionally driven and it's layered with, I guess, all these things that I've experienced as a person. So I think emotionally it carries a lot of who I am. Visually, God, that's a hard one, dude. I never even think about my style. It's just kind of what I do, but it's not.
So, like, how let's talk about fashion, like fashion from a Black perspective.
Okay,
where do you see fashion? I know they have like Black Fashion Week in London. I think what, in August or October, or is it this fall or
Fashion Week or something like that? Yeah.
Like, what are your thoughts on fashion from a Black perspective? Because now I'm guessing we're in a position where we have to develop our own brands and I guess like what you're doing, create our own way. Do you feel that people, the Black collective in London, they're on board with that? Or are they still trying to fight their way or break into industries or that historically won't let us in?
I think it's a bit of both. So I do feel that, that there is a struggle for Black creatives and Black designers to kind of break through the industry. There are one or two who do, and sometimes it's, you know, they're really talented and they really are, you know, they're really, what's the word? Their talent is undeniable. So someone like Duro Onowu, who's just an amazing designer and does a lot of stuff with prints. He's a Nigerian designer, but he's here in London. But his work is, you know, is seen on the catwalks, and, you know, he's really, he's highly revered. And, you know, I've met him before. His work is amazing. But I think the Black community sometimes find struggle to actually break into the industry. I think part of it sometimes is aesthetics. You know, there's a Black look to I guess their work, so sometimes they're not allowed to break in. Also, it's things like they aren't as connected into the industry, and that's a challenge. You're not as connected into the industry, and you know, some of these creative industries are it's a bit of a bubble, and so some on, you know, they're still within the industry, but they're not within that bubble. So to actually break in is quite hard. The work has to be really exceptional. And even when it's exceptional, if it's not seen by the right people, it doesn't break through. So it's quite sad because I see a lot of talented designers who can't.
Oh, absolutely. Break. So you're doing well for yourself. What kind of tips or secrets can you give the people who are, you know, are people who are trying to break through and just they've hit a hit a wall, or, and you know, and they're becoming discouraged? Like, what kind of advice would you give them?
Be true to yourself.
Okay.
Tell your own story. There's no one that can tell your story like you can. And I think we are sometimes, even as Africans, you know, when I look around at sometimes at African photography, and it's not, it's hard to generalize. There are some general instances, but I feel like we are copying and we aren't telling our own story. And it's important to really be honest and be true to yourself and tell your story through your images or through whatever you create. It's very important to, I guess, be who you are meant to be. As I said, nobody can tell your story like you can. And you have a unique perspective that the whole world doesn't have. So tell your story that way. And I think people get discouraged because they see what's hot, they see what the trends are, and they kind of want to jump on the trends. I say, don't jump on the trends. Just be who you are and create what comes from within. So yeah, that's the kind of advice I'll give. It's not the greatest advice because it's
I mean, start. What, now tell us somewhat your story as far as how long it took for you to get to where you're at as far as, you know, landing campaigns and major magazines.
My thing was to kind of, I guess when I first started taking photos, I thought I would learn from others, and that's great. And then I thought I would travel along the path other people traveled, but I found that that doesn't work. I think the thing to do is stay on your path. And so I first started taking photos. I took photos of everything. You know, I was just learning. So I took loads of photos of everything. And then I found I was interested in telling stories and narratives. So when I took, when I created portraits, I made sure they were about the person or about me and the person. And there was a story involved. I think when I started to do that, when I started to look inward in terms of the images, then, you know, everything started to kind of slot into place. And I tried not to, the important thing was not to copy, not to worry about what everyone else is doing, but to kind of focus on my truth and what I think is important. Right now, I'm trying to tell stories about Africa, And I'm hoping this year I can start traveling and even telling more and inspiring stories. So I think the work will just really continue to grow from there. The thing is, I don't go out looking for work.
Okay. Well, yeah, you don't have to, because people are coming to you now.
But then that's the thing. When I initially first started, I was chasing. So I gave up my job, which was my 9-to-5 working in the.
Okay, let's finish your story, then I ask some more questions. Go ahead and finish. I don't want to cut you off.
So I gave up my job and I started working as a full-time photographer. I'd been working in Belgium for about 2 years, working for a company out there. Came back to London and then decided, you know what? I think I'm good enough. So I'm going to quit my job. I put some money together and I did it for about a year and a half and I hated it. It was the worst thing. I was nearly depressed. Mm-hmm. It was horrible. I wasn't making money. I was constantly having to chase work. It mm-hmm. sucked. Mm-hmm. So I decided, you know what? I don't love this anymore. So I gave it up, went back to work. And then I only started to focus on stories that interested me. I didn't chase any work. It was all about me just creating things that I wanted to create. And I did it for the joy of it.
Right.
And then somehow it started to work out.
So when you left your job, what point did you get to, or where were you at in your life when you said, you know what, or what sign did you give when you said, you know what, it's time for me to leave my job and pursue my dream? Like what sign did you have? Did it just happen overnight? Did you just go cold turkey and say, go into the office and say, you know what, I'm going to quit today and I'm going to pursue my passion? Like how did it play out?
I think I'm a bit cautious. And second of all, you know, I am married. I have a house. Mm-hmm. You know, all those things cost money.
You have kids?
No.
Okay.
We're gonna have kids. So okay. No way I was just gonna like quit and walk away. I have responsibilities. So what I did was I did it over a period of time.
Okay.
You know, sometimes jump back into a contract, do a contract for, I don't know, 6 months or 3 months, jump back out and do photography. So I was kind of shifting between both worlds. The idea that I'm just going to completely quit my job just didn't really resonate with me because I'd done it before mm-hmm. and sucked and it wasn't great. So
okay.
I made sure that I did it very cautiously and very, I made sure I had enough money to be able to save for a period of time. And it was important that I just didn't take a crazy decision. Now, for some people that works and that's perfectly fine. But for me, it just wasn't gonna work. You have to understand your circumstances and who you are.
Now I'm starting to notice, man, Nigerians, Nigerians and Ghanaians, when it comes to the art space, you guys are, you guys are doing pretty well. Like there's a lot of hype Nigerian artists out there. Let me ask you, what separates an artist and makes them unique versus another artist? Because you're right, there's a lot of artists who are kind of put themselves in a box by mimicking other artists or mimicking trends. Oh, here we go. Can you still hear me?
I can hear you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, perfect. Yeah, it's just my... I want to make sure my Wi-Fi isn't acting up.
Yeah.
How does one separate himself?
Oh, dear.
Very saturated field industry. How does one separate themselves from other artists? I guess that's my question.
You have to be true to yourself. You have to stay your lane and create what's important to you. What is your truth? I sometimes give talks to other photographers and creatives, and one of the things I will say to them is, what story do you want to tell, or what do you want to talk about that you feel will affect the world and will affect your world, and how honest do you want to be about your work? I think the strange thing I found out as I came through my career is there is no formula or no magic bullet. So the way somebody develops in their career is going to be very different from the way you develop in your career. And the big, I guess the big thing that will make you a superstar is very different. And it's not sometimes the thing you think it will be. So if you're the idea that there's a thing is just not going to work. I think you have to focus on your art and keep creating, even when the money's not coming in. Keep creating and be truthful to yourself. I think. Yeah.
Oh, go ahead. I'm sorry. Finish your statement.
That was it.
Okay. Do you see yourself ever relocating permanently back to Nigeria, or are you going to operate out of London for the moment?
I don't know, dude. I want to, but I don't think I will. I'm unsure. You never know what's going to happen tomorrow. Right. My things now are, I love Nigeria, but I don't think I could live. Maybe I've been too anglicized. I don't know.
Right.
I'm used to a certain way of life. Mm-hmm. It's the silly things. So in Nigeria, you go there and there's no electricity. My dad has two generators. Why should my dad have two generators? He has two generators because one could pack up and because there's constantly no light. So he has to have a generator to make sure that there's light around. It's things like that. Nigeria is such an amazing country and we have so many natural resources, but we don't manage properly. So we don't manage what we have properly. We should have light 24/7. I mean, Ghana has lights 24/7. Why don't we have light?
Right. And that was going to be my next question. Why? And you kind of answered it with your question. What's the issue with Nigeria as far as electricity? Because everywhere else I go, it's not a problem. But for some reason, in Nigeria, it's an issue. Is it just it's overpopulated or, I mean, what?
We just don't manage stuff well. And everybody, well, not everybody, but quite a few people are interested in what they can get. Mm-hmm. So it's a big corruption thing. It's like, you know, in government. Okay, so case in point here.
Go ahead.
My sister-in-law, right, goes to a church, big, nice church in Lagos. It's of in course. The city of Lagos. Now, the roads that lead up to that church
are great. Yes.
They're terrible.
Terrible. Okay, my bad. But the church is beautiful. Beautiful.
Exactly. The church is beautiful. Okay. Right? But the road that.
It's like here in America, same thing.
Yeah, but the road that leads to it is broken up. It's messy. It's a complete state. Now, the mm-hmm. church decides, okay, you know what? We can contribute money and sort out that road. It's the road that leads to our church. You know,
but they're not going to.
No, they actually decide to do it. Now, right. They are going to about to start to do it, and they inform the government that, hey, look, you know, we need to do this. The government says, no, you don't do it. We do it. You give us the money you made that you've put together to that you've contributed,
oh, wow.
And then we'll fix the road. Come on. And this is a problem in Nigeria. It's like everybody's always chasing contracts and how to make money. And, you know, the government gives people contracts. They use half of the money or even more than half of the money to pay off other people that have helped them get that contract. And then they take the money away themselves. And then they repair the road with a quarter of what they're given. We have a big corruption issue in Nigeria. Now, I've heard the current president is tried or is trying. I don't know how that's working out. But I think there's an inherent issue with Nigerians to have. I don't know why our leaders are so corrupt. I don't get it.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, Buhari passed a law that all contracts, like pretty much, if it's a job that a Nigerian can do, they're not going to look for outside companies outside of Nigeria, non-Nigerians, to come in and do that job. So, I mean, I guess that's a good thing.
Is yeah. It that, okay. That's a good thing. You know, it's good to keep the stuff in. But then the people that are doing it, are they doing a good job? are they being, what's the word? When you show what you're doing, I can't remember the word, but are they being transparent? You know, where is the money going? Is the money used to fix the things, or are they taking half of it away to pay to, you know, to and take it away and not really use it to fix what needs to be fixed? I think there's a psychological thing that we need to sort out in that country. And I'm hoping that as time goes on, we will. I don't know if it's changing or not. I hope it is. Okay. But
somebody in the chat room, where's the question? Legendary Mother, who's also Nigerian, wants to know, what mediums of art do you like best?
So I love photography, obviously. I go and see a lot of painting and mixed media work. What else? I think I love all forms of art, as long, I guess, if it resonates with me emotionally. So I could see a piece of work that just resonates and just hits me emotionally. But obviously photography, I love sculpture, I love music. Music's big. I love music.
So, yeah. I was gonna say, what, you know, being Black in London, what, I guess, adversity do you face as far as being Black in London?
I think, so this is a hard one. I think in London, it's very different from you guys in the States.
Oh, of course. I could agree with that.
It's a different beast. I think that people are, their narrative of Africans is what they see on TV. So when I first moved to the UK, I'd finished my secondary school and I moved to the UK to start my A-levels in school. You know, people were surprised at the kind of English I spoke. And then, you know, the usual thing was, oh, you speak very well for an African or for an
Asian. Hey, we get that over here too.
And I just thought, that's stupid. What do you mean I speak very well? Of course, I, you know, we do have schools there and we do learn quite a bit. And in some instances, we're ahead. So I don't understand how. So I guess it's the idea we're looked down upon and we're not seen. And Africans are stereotyped into a certain role. Either, you know, we are the guy that is a drug dealer or has a low income type job.
Right.
So it's very stereotypical. Now, in terms of, I think that narrative is beginning to change. And I think that's one of the things I enjoy doing through my work, is actually telling that this narrative is wrong. And I think that's, we need to start telling truths about where we're from and what we as Africans are. We should be proud of that. It's one of the things I love about the Black Panther film. I saw it on Friday.
You already saw it? You guys, we have a superstar. He didn't see the bootleg, okay? He was at the London European preview, okay? Red carpet, okay? He didn't watch the bootleg from the barbershop. He was actually at the official London release. What's the term?
It was a screening. I mean, it was great. We got to actually meet Ryan Coogler, who also gave a talk, and he saw some of the work I did, because I worked with this lady. Her name is Selma Nichols, and she did this thing called Looks. Well, she owns this talent agency called Looks Like Me, and from we did this whole inspired by Black Panther. So I think the BFI, who are the British Film Institute, saw the images because she worked with them on them, and you know, we got to go, so which is great.
Yeah, my bad. The premiere. He was at the premiere. Yeah, the official premiere. What? Don't give us any spoilers. Okay, I just need to know, was the movie good or not? That's all I need to know. Don't lie. Was it good or not?
In my opinion, I'm gonna go see anyway, but it was really strong.
It was really strong? Okay, good.
it's different. I mean, I'm a comic book kid, so I've seen all the Marvel films, but this film was different. And it showed us in amazing light. So I was blown away by it. I'm going to see it again this weekend.
Okay, so you're going to see it twice, so then it's legit.
I'm
going to
see it twice, definitely.
Yeah, so I'm going to go see it too. It releases. In fact, I might go see it a Thursday night. It's going to be packed, so I might go see it the following week.
Yeah, it's going to be packed. Are you ready for people dressed up in African attire?
This is my issue, and I did a video on this, Asiko. See, this is my issue. Number one, okay, I can't stand looking at a fake dashiki, all right? And so people, I can't stand a fake dashiki from India or China. Can't stand it. And people have been saying that I'm being too hard. But this is my issue, Asiko, with that.
If I
wear a fake Rolex, people are going to get on me. If I wear some fake Air Jordans or some fake Louis Vuitton, people are going to clown and roast you. But for some reason, fake dashikis are off limits. Yeah. And you don't understand the hate messages and the Dynasty, you're wrong. Oh, yeah, Dynasty, you're wrong. You know, we're trying to get in contact with we're trying to connect with our culture. You're an asshole, Dynasty. Who are you to judge? But I'm like, look, if I came on my stream every day with a fake Louis Vuitton shirt and a fake Rolex, people will be roasting me. But for some reason, fake dashikis are off limits because there's a bunch of fake dashikis that are just circulating around Atlanta and America. And just me traveling to Africa, tell the difference between a real one and a fake. Now, the argument is Dynasty, wax isn't made in Africa. And you're correct. But you can still tell a difference from something that's hand African made versus something that's just put together from India or China. That's sold at a corner store by Miss Lee. So,
Of course. Yeah, I find it really interesting, though, that in American, I'm seeing a lot more in America, not as much in the UK, but there's this whole reconnection back to Africa. So you watch the Lemonade video, you see it's becoming in popular culture, which I find really interesting. There's this whole connection. Now, how real it is, I do not know, but I guess I'm loving that. You know, I'm seeing more people dressed in African attire. I mean, it's funny, I actually didn't wear any African attire to the Black Panther screening that I went to, but then I don't think I need clothes to tell me that I'm African. I feel I'm already connected being African anyway. But yeah, it's interesting.
Yeah, but I gotta, I usually wear a lot of my African clothing because I get it made, you know, when I'm over there. It's just like, why not wear it? I'm not just gonna.
Where do you get your stuff from? Because I've seen,
Senegal.
Oh, really?
I'm telling you, man, Senegal, I know you're Nigerian, I know you guys get to the point where you argue about who has the best jollof rice.
I know.
Senegal, in my honest opinion, I'm going to Nigeria. Actually, what part of Nigeria are you from?
So I'm from Lagos. And
okay.
I'm Yoruba. Yeah.
Yeah, somebody was asking it because they thought your name was Hassa. Somebody was asking. Yeah. Somebody was asking. But I'm actually in August, I'm going to the Osun Festival. So I'm gonna go to Benin City, Il Ife, first week of August, I'm going to Nigeria.
Dude, we need to talk.
Are you coming?
I'm interested. I really wanted to go to Ouidah.
I won't go back to Ouidah to the Voodoo Festival till next January. That's just every January.
I'm definitely going next year as well, in January.
Yeah.
Look, we should definitely talk. I didn't. So you're going to the Osun Festival?
Yeah, I'm going. In fact, I was trying to buy my ticket today. In fact, with that being said, guys, listen. So American Express, I'm going to post the link here in a second. Let me ask you a question so I'm not running my mouth all day. you know, you get when you guys sign up for an American Express credit card, make sure you guys are responsible with your credit. If you guys sign up for one for the Sky Miles, and usually they have promotions where if you spend a certain amount in 3 months, they'll give you 60,000 Sky Miles. So I have a link. If you guys sign up through my link, I get some Sky Miles. And I'm like that close, okay, to hitting where I need to hit to get my ticket to Nigeria. All right. Yeah. I'm almost there, but I will be there regardless. Sky Miles or not, I will be at the Osun Festival first week. It's like August 6th to the 17th. So I plan on, of course, going to Lagos, staying in Lagos for like a day, a couple of days. Then I'm going to go to Benin City, Ile-Ife, and then I'm going to go to Osun, wherever that's at.
Definitely. Oh, thank you. I think I definitely will start making plans.
Yeah. So, yeah, man. So I would definitely, I'm going, you know, everybody's been talking about it. So I'm definitely going. And there's also like a Yam Festival, but that's later. But they said the Osun Festival is, you know, what you have to experience. So I'm definitely, I am definitely going to do it. So if you want to meet up, I'm flying Delta. Delta flies direct to Lagos. Let me ask you this. Are you familiar with the Nigerian airline, Eric Air?
Yeah.
They used to fly direct from New York to Lagos, but they stopped it.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I have no clue. I've never flown on it, and I'm as sad as it is, I've not flown on a Nigerian airline since I was a kid. When I was a kid, we used to fly Nigerian Airways. My mom used to work for them, so we used to fly with them. But ever since they packed up shop, I haven't flown on a Nigerian plane, and I plan not to anytime soon.
Okay, all right. Is it that bad?
Yeah, I think we're sometimes we struggle with just making things work properly and just organizing things properly. And I think, I just wouldn't. I just need to get, you know, when I'm flying, I don't like flying. Flying is stressful for me, from where you have to do your checkpoints all the way to getting on the flight and then getting off. I hate the whole thing. So I need it as stress-free as possible. So I just won't do it. Not right now.
Let me ask you this question. And I don't want to offend you. See, this is the issue. This is what I don't understand about Nigeria. Nigerians are so freaking smart.
Yeah, we are.
I mean, they come over here, they dominate in school, they're lawyers, doctors. They pretty much, they could, in Atlanta, they control the dialysis space. You know, you have great visual artists. Mm. I mean, the music out of Nigeria is great. Mm. What's the issue? Like, I just don't know. What's the issue?
I don't know. I wish I knew. Do you know one thing I've seen? So living in the UK, I get exposed to very different cultures and loads of different races. I love London because it's a melting pot of different races. People that I would never even have met if I lived in Nigeria, who are Africans as well. I tend to meet them in London. Now, the thing is, so I've come across Indians here, right?
Right.
The great Indians is they work together to push everything together. And because of that, they are successful. I feel we do not do this as Nigerians.
See, I somewhat disagree because outside of Nigeria, obviously, Nigeria, work very well together here in America. They're like, they work like Indians, kind of.
Okay.
They don't have, you know, I would say a specific industry unlock like Indians do with IT, where they have like a, you know, pretty much a system where, I mean, if you're in India, you just come to America and Indians, you they have like a just a system in place that you could just come step right in. I don't know if Nigerians have that yet, but they have. I mean, Nigerians are doing very well here in America, very well.
But is it that they're doing very well for themselves or very well as a community? Because it's one thing to do very well for yourself. And when somebody looks at it from the outside, they will see all these different Nigerians are hustling and doing well. That doesn't mean that they are working together as a unit, or we have what the Indians or the Jews have. It's a very, very different thing. And I think this is our problem. Even in Nigeria, we don't work together. Everybody is in it for how much money I can get, as opposed to what can we do to move our society forward. Everybody's trying to make their buck. So I think, I mean, I don't know what it is in the States, but I think that's the thing. Nigerians are very determined, very intelligent, very artistic, and we go out there and do great things, but we don't do it together as a community. We do. And it's strange because that's such an African thing, to have community, to foster community, but somehow we're not doing it well, or something's amiss somewhere.
Yeah, but I would say just coming from the Black American community, the standard as far as working together, unfortunately, isn't that high. And I see Nigerians doing way better as far as work. I mean, really, really working together. I mean, Nigerians are doing very well here in America. Like you said, it's probably different. You said it's different in London, but Nigerians are doing very well. Here in America. So,
but then I also think that, I think America is quite a different kettle of fish. You know, sky's the limit in America. Sometimes there is no ceiling. You know, you can just break through. Mm-hmm. And things like that are evidenced by, think about how many Black celebrities you have that are high up there. Your Beyoncé's, your Jay-Z's.
Yeah, but let me cut you off though. I gotta stop you right there. But what are they doing for the Black community? That's the thing.
Okay, I see.
They're not. I mean, they're what measurable can you see outside of them being celebrities, individuals? Mm-hmm. How are they contributing to the Black community? Like, the issue is they're not. Mm-hmm. I mean, they're not. So that's the thing. Yes, we have celebrities because you have to look at it. You know, and I don't know. Are you familiar with Clyde Anderson?
No.
Okay, so Clyde Anderson is an economist here in America, black economist. Okay. And he had a great point, and it makes sense. Mm-hmm. The reason why people like Jay-Z, Beyonce, a lot of athletes and Black entertainers are where they are is because they do a great job at entertaining white people. I mean, I'm just being honest. That's what it is. You know, I mean, seriously, that's at the end of the day, that's what it is. But they're not. I mean, they are now because of Donald Trump. You know, ever since Donald Trump is in office, people are becoming more conscious, you know, starting to speak out more. But it's like if Hillary Clinton was in office, they wouldn't be speaking out or doing nothing at all. So, you know, that you know, like even like Obama did nothing for Black people. In fact, if you look at the Libyan slave trade, it's because of decisions Obama and Hillary Clinton made.
Oh, really?
I mean, Libya, the destabilization of Libya. Because Libya was fine, completely fine. Gaddafi, everything was fine before Clinton and Obama decided to bomb him. That's what I'm saying. Like, it's all individualistic. You know? So, like, Black Panther is a great movie. I'm going to see Black Panther. I'm going to support it. But none of that money is going to be circulated. In fact, there's a petition, and it's stupid, but people are trying. They're like, okay, Black Panther's about to make so much money off of Black people. Some of that money needs to come back to the Black community. It's not going to, you know. But
then shouldn't we be taking the charge for ourselves?
You're absolutely right. We should. But the thing is, unfortunately, you know, our superstars, as you mentioned, the celebrities, they got so comfortable, you know, and content with getting a check from corporations that are like, well, I have my car, I have my big house. Why should I invest in any type of infrastructure where the Black collective doesn't have to worry about nothing because I'm good? So that's what it is, you know.
You see. That's quite sad.
Yeah. So, you know, that's just what it is. So, you know, we talk about celebrities, but I mean, they're not like, if you look at Jay-Z's community, where he's from. So are you guys probably are dealing with it in London too, gentrification?
Oh God. Yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, like, where all these rappers are from is completely gentrified.
Really? And
so people are like, completely gentrified. So now, I mean, they're like complaining about, oh, black people are being pushed out, white people are coming in, it's not fair. But it's like all this money through these entertainers and rappers who literally made, as a collective, billions of dollars talking about how they were selling dope and killing people in these communities. They didn't reinvest none of that money back into the community. But now when white people are coming in and people are being gentrified in this place, now they're all upset. But it's like, dude, they were giving away. Like, I live in an area in Atlanta called the West End. All right. Okay. It's being gentrified, but I bought before the prices went up. They were giving away houses here for dirt cheap.
Really?
But that's how it is. What they do, they drive the, like, this is how the game works. Now, I got to do another show on this. This is how the game works. Whenever you have, so I don't know how it is in London, but here in America, you have what is called white flight. All right. So you have predominantly white communities after segregation,
mm-hmm.
black people started to move into those communities. Okay. What happened? White people left. And then what happened? The prices went down.
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
Then I would say like the middle class black people, they started to leave those communities because, again, the grass is greener on the other side of the fence. So I have money now. Let me go to the suburbs of white people. They left, and then just left was the poor black community in these communities. Then, of course, you had the drug issues, high crime, and these prices just went. I mean, damn near nothing. You could have got a house.
Really?
So everything started to move to the city. That's why it's called the inner city, the ghetto, the inner city.
Mm-hmm.
And so white people were like, look, I live way out here in the suburbs. I have to commute all the way to the city to work every day, and it's far, and I'm wasting gas.
Mm-hmm.
You're trying to tell me I could get this house, and these houses are beautiful. They're old craftsmen, Victorian homes that they look like shit, but you buy them for dirt cheap. You go in and completely renovate them, and they're absolutely beautiful.
Yeah.
So what happened? The white people started moving back in. Prices starting to go up.
Of course.
You try to tell your black friends who had money, hey, you guys need to come back to the city. They're like, no, we're not coming. And they, you know, and their excuse was, it's not going to change. It's going to, you know, still going to be bad. Okay, you guys have a few white people there, but it's still going to be bad. It's not going to change. I'm going to stay out in the suburbs. Then more white people start coming in. Prices start going up. And then when the prices go up, the taxes go up too. So, you know, Auntie Grandma Cheryl, who had her house, all right, that she paid off, is now the city values it, raises the value on it. The taxes go up. She can't afford the taxes. So now she's out.
Ouch.
Yeah. And then more people come in, predominantly white. And then the black people who are out in the suburbs start crying, oh, they're gentrifying the city. And it's like, well, you could have came to the city. Had a piece of your pie. But what happens, these suburbs that are now predominantly black, the values go down. The housing values go down.
Jeez.
And so they're stuck in the suburbs now, and the values are down. Meanwhile, in the inner city, the prices are up.
They're up.
It's a really lack of black ownership in the cities now. And then if you're black and you're renting, since the home values are going up, the rents go up. And then you have these people that get, I guess, have to move out. So it's just a whole big thing, man. But again, when these prices were, the houses were dirt cheap, our black millionaires and entertainers could have came in, fixed up all these houses for nothing, brought in the infrastructure as far as the grocery stores and all that. But they didn't do it.
Mm.
So I hope that makes sense. Guys, yeah. That makes sense.
It's actually quite interesting. It's different. It feels a bit different from what's happening here.
Let me cut you. So Tag Team made a great point in the chat room. He's absolutely right. Like literally where I live in the West End, houses were going for $30,000 USD.
What?
Listen. But listen, now these houses are going for like 400 to 450,000 USD.
That's crazy.
Yeah, because you buy them, you go in, you fix them up, you might spend $60,000. So now you're in at $90,000. And then the prices just go up out the roof. So it's going on right now. And in New York, it was crazy. But yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Wow. I think in London, it feels like all the places that are, you know, the places that were not so desirable, like places like Brixton or Peckham in the south of London. What happened is a lot of bunch of young creative people end up moving into those places and, you know, they start building businesses and they're very, very entrepreneurial. So, and because of all that happened in the economy, people are building their own businesses. And because of that, loads of coffee shops and, you know, creative art centers are opening up. And then by the time you know it, the prices start to go up, the black people are kind of edged out. And then all these young white families move in.
Hipster. We call it hipsters. That's what we say.
They move in and then it just changes the whole dynamic. And then somewhere, a place like Brixton, which is not desirable and people were constantly getting gunned down, now has coffee shops and fashion shops all over the place.
That's exactly how it is in Atlanta and LA. Like the coffee shops come in, the organic farm to table restaurants, the H&M and the, you know, the fashion, boutiques come in. That's exactly how it is. So it's like a worldwide thing.
Yep. Very much. But yeah.
Yeah. So let's see if we got any more. So let me ask, so the black people that were in Brixton, where are they being moving, relocated to now?
So they're moving out to the, how can I put this? I think, so London's kind of divided up by zones. Uh-huh. So places like Brixton are zone two. Zone one is obviously up where a lot of things are happening. So zone two, people move out from zone two and they move out to places like zone four, zone five, or they move out to the outskirts of London. So it just, obviously these places are a bit cheaper, but the closer, everything that's in zone two is going to end up being gentrified basically over the next couple of years. That's going to be how it is. Because people want to commute into London, well, into the center of London easier. So yeah, just changes the game.
Yeah, that's crazy. I see you in the chat room. Please send me your address, please. Send me your address so I can send you your postcard. I might have sent it out already, but please send it again. See, what confuses me is you guys have your tag names or your screen names, then you have your real names, and sometimes if I send it to you guys or not. So, Nadoop, in the chat room, please email me again. Again, you guys, when you subscribe to Patreon or when you super chat, you get a postcard. And Asiko, for you being a guest today, I'm going to send you a postcard as well. So just do me a favor, just Instagram me your address and I will get one out no later than tomorrow. So there you go. Hello?
Where was that? Hello.
This was shot in Kumasi at the Akwesasne Festival in Kumasi, Ghana.
Nice. Very nice.
Yeah, so Instagram me your
Your
address and I'll get one out to you.
Yeah, thank you.
And thank you so much for coming on. We'll go ahead and close out. You have the final word, you know, whatever you want to say. Also give people your contact information, how they can reach you and all that.
Yeah.
Good
stuff. Yeah. So, interesting year ahead for me. And if anybody wants to find out what I do and what I talk about or what my art is about, you can follow me on Instagram at Asiko, Asiko_artist. I live on Instagram, and Instagram is kind of my office, my virtual office. So if anybody wants to get in contact with me or see what I do, yeah, just reach out there. I've got an exhibition in a few months that I'm working on. So if people just kind of stay in touch, they'll see details of it. And it's going to be my first solo show in London. So looking forward to that. But yeah, thank you for having me. And it was great to, you know, chat and rub minds and, you know, kind of hear where you're coming from. And hopefully we could do something interesting together.
Oh, absolutely. You know, I'm down to collab, man. I mean, the objective of this platform was to connect the diaspora with Africa. So, mm-hmm. you know, it's because I think that's lacking, because I see a lot of people talking about the diaspora and talk about Pan-African, but then it's just they're talking about that in their own black circle, and they're not including other Africans or other black people, the diaspora. So, you know, I like to reach out to the diaspora all over the planet, because we're everywhere, we're scattered. Yep. And get us connected back to who we are and our roots. So, you know, just thank you for coming back on, and I appreciate it.
Yeah, I appreciate you too. Thanks a lot, man. Thanks for inviting.
No problem. And guys, I'm going to put in the description box, and also I'll put in the chat room. If you guys are interested in collecting Sky Miles, I sent the link, use my link, sign up for the American Express Sky Miles card, Delta Sky Miles card. And there you go. Also go to Instagram.com. Search for Huru on Instagram, Snapchat, Twitter, and Facebook. Make sure you go to DynastyMirror.com. Make sure you go to SearchForHuru.com. And make sure you go to Amazon.com. Search your name, Dynasty Mirror. Please buy a book. Everybody, I appreciate you all coming on. I got to go pick up my son from school.
Oh, wow.
So till next time. And Asiko, you have a home here now. All my guests who come on have a home here. So whenever you want to come back on, you know, let me know. And we can make it happen.
Sure. Thanks a lot, Ruth. Thank you so much.
No problem, man. All right, you guys. Peace.
Have a good evening.
You too.